Winter School, the ITAMP to Winter School. It's amazing that almost 6 years ago that Pierre and I was just an idea to have a little coffee and a lot of things. Some of the lecturers have been here before, including Professor Girvin, who gave the introductory lecture. So this is very unique. As you can see, it's a sort of a very isolated place. It's intentionally done so. We can't have winter schools in Boston because it's just not. It's just not good. But here, another room is accommodating, it's comfortable. One of the things that I think you should definitely try to take advantage of the students that is a part of here is because you sit with the lecturers for breakfast, for lunch, for dinner, really to sit with them and interact. There's a lot you can gain than just sitting and listening to the lectures when you sit with them and socially interact. So I'm highly happy that I think Steve would love to do so.
Sure.
And others as well. So a few of the technicalities. There are some social activities, including one this evening. It's going to be a reception before dinner in the biosphere, not inside the biosphere, which is also where you go on a tour. I think Kim will have a sign-up sheet for that, but we're going to be on the outside of it, still indoors, but outside the enclosure. We'll have the reception, and that's where the dinner is going to be also. And so I think we'll start the activities at 5:30. The afternoons are free, meaning that lecturers, if so wish, they can actually do their homework. That would be your free time. So this up. Let's see if there is anything else. If there are questions, you can ask me, you can ask Alice, Kim, and we'll be here. So without any further ado, then we'll go to the floor.
Alice, do I have to stand near the microphone in order
so,
that to be recorded? Or?
Yeah, we could have an issue with the wireless microphone.
It's okay.
But no, go ahead.
Okay.
That's fine.
So I'm going to be giving three lectures about the quantum electrodynamics of electrical circuits and called circuit TPD. Which, instead of lasers, will have microwave signal sources. Instead of atoms, we'll have nonlinear Josen junction circuits. Superconducting system cooled down in your absence. And we'll be able to achieve, because these are handmade large-scale atoms, they'll have extremely strong coupling to the quantum fluctuations in the electromagnetic field, and we'll be able to do interesting things with that. So I hope that you all feel free to interrupt and ask me questions. I'd much rather uncover a little than uncover a lot. So I'll start with how do you quantize? If you're an electrical engineer, how do you learn how to quantize a black box that contains various circuit elements, some of which might be lumped element things, some of which might be distributed waveguides and so forth? Then talk about how the artificial atom works and how it's dispersively coupled to a microwave cavity, and you can use that to read out the state of the qubit. We can achieve in this system strong coupling at a level that's essentially impossible with ordinary optical cavity QED. We'll be able to get light shifts, quantized light shifts of the artificial atom frequency depending on how many individual photons are in the cavity, so you can use that to count photons. And then, at the end, I'll try to introduce the idea that we can rather remarkably measure the parity in a gap without measuring the photon number. A very fancy measurement from a cavity QD point of view, but one which is actually quite easy to do in this experimental realization. Then subsequent lectures will take advantage of all the amazing things that you can do if you can measure photon number parity. All right, so first, introduction to how you quantize electrical circuits, how you build artificial atoms, and how you become a quantum electron. So we'll just start with a couple LC oscillator. And there'll be charge on the capacitor, there'll be current flowing through the inductor, and it's useful to define what I call the generalized flux. It's related to a minus sign to the magnetic flux inside the inductor, but it's simply the time integral of the voltage at this node relative to ground. So its time derivative is the voltage, which up to a possible minus sign should remind you of Faraday induction. And we can write the electrostatic energy stored in the capacitor as 1/2 the capacitance times the voltage squared. That looks a lot like 1/2 mass times velocity squared of a mechanical oscillator. And we can write the magnetic energy stored in the inductor as 1/2 inductance times the current squared. But because the current is linearly related to the flux, I can write that as 1/2 the inductance times the square of the flux. So that should remind you of this 1/2 inductance looks like spring constant, and this looks like the square of the position of a harmonic oscillator.
That's it.
Okay.
Kinetic energy minus potential energy looks a lot like a harmonic oscillator with a coordinate phi. And one of the things I like about this is when I first learned to quantize the electromagnetic field, I was more confused by the infinite number of degrees of freedom than by the quantum mechanics. And here, where I have a lumped element circuit, this is going to be an electromagnetic mode. It's going to have quanta, it's going to have photons in it. But there's only this one degree of freedom, so it's a little easier to understand. Okay, so in order to quantize it, I need the Hamiltonian. So with malice aforethought, I'm going to name that canonical momentum that I need Q. It's the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the velocity, which is C phi dot, which is nothing but capacitance times voltage, and that, of course, is the charge on the capacitor. So the momentum conjugate to the coordinate, which is the flux, is the charge. I could also have made that be the coordinate and this be the flux be the momentum. But for when we get to Joseph junctions, it's easier to do it this way. So the Hamiltonian is momentum times velocity minus Lagrangian. It's just q squared over 2c plus phi squared over 2l. So the electrostatic potential energy in the capacitor appears as kinetic energy, momentum squared divided by twice the mass. And the kinetic energy stored in the currents appears as potential energy, flux squared divided by 2 and multiplied by the spring constant, which is 1 over the inductance. So if I just take the expression for the frequency of the oscillator spring constant divided by mass, I get the usual 1 over square root LC. And if I take the Hamilton equations of motion, I get that phi dot is voltage and q dot is minus the current. So the current flowing is removing charge from the capacitor. That the minus sign that appears in Hamilton's equation all works out to give you charge conservation. Okay, questions so far? So if I just write down the classical equations of motion, the solutions of course are sinusoidal. And so if I think of the current as having some amplitude times sine of t, and the voltage having units of voltage, so I need that same current multiplied by some quantity that has units of resistance. And that quantity is called the characteristic impedance of the resonator. It's not associated with dissipation. It's just an L and C. There's no resistors. But that quantity, which you, when you plug these into the equations of motion, you'll see that that characteristic resistance is just the reactive impedance of the capacitor at the resonance frequency, or the square root of L divided by C. So the frequency is 1 over square root of LC. The characteristic impedance is square root of L over C. And it's difficult to build circuits where that number is very different, is outside of the range of sort of 50 or 25 to 500 ohms. And that's because the impedance of free space, which is the square root of mu naught over epsilon naught, is 377 ohms. That when you build an inductor, it also has stray capacitance. Build a capacitor, it also has stray inductance. And it's very hard to build a circuit where the parameters are much different from this. If I just have a piece of straight wire in some circuit, up to logarithms that have to do with the distance between that wire and other wires or ground planes, the inductance per unit length of that wire is mu naught, and the capacitance per unit length is epsilon naught, and the characteristic impedance is, you know, 50-ish to 100-ish, a couple hundred-ish ohms. And there's another characteristic impedance which played an important role in my previous life as a quantum Hall effect person. That's the Crookes impedance, 25,812.807... ohms. And that's Planck's constant divided by the quantum of charge squared. And the ratio of those two quantities is up to a factor of 2, the fine structure constant. One thing that's confusing about the fine structure constant, it's dimensionless, so you would think its expression doesn't depend on what units you're using. Think of it as e squared over h bar c, at least theorists do. But in SI units, you have to put a 4 pi epsilon naught there because of the e squared. So the impedance of free space and the quantum impedance are related by the fine structure constant. And the fact that the fine structure constant is small is reflected in the rather disparate values of those impedances.
So you have to ask a question?
Yeah.
So what's the kind of meaning of the quantum of impedance in the context of the superconductor?
The meaning of what?
Of quantum of impedance. What's the significance?
So the significance of the quantum of impedance
if you looked at an artificial atom and thought of it as an LC oscillator, approximately, if its impedance were approaching the quantum of impedance, then the uncertainty in the charge, the charge fluctuations of the dipole are approaching one point. That will appear to actually be shorter. That's a good question. Okay, so we're electrical engineers now. We want to quantize things, so we just put hats on top of everything. The momentum doesn't commute with the position. And we know that we can represent the Hamiltonian of the oscillator in terms of creation and annihilation operators, which will have this commutation relation, which will realize this canonical commutation relation, provided that the flux is something with units of flux times this dimensionless thing. Charge is something with units of charge times this thing. And those are the scales of the zero-point fluctuations of the flux and the charge in the circuit. And how big those are actually are related to Misha's question about what's the significance of the quantum of impedance. So how big are those quantities? Well, you can go through the whole derivation, but I always like to remember kind of from the virial theorem that in the quantum ground state, there's half a quantum of energy, and one half of that energy is stored on the capacitor, and one half is stored on the inductor. And that tells me how big these zero-point fluctuation quantities must be. The charge is the square root of h bar over twice the characteristic impedance, and the flux is h bar over 2 times the characteristic. Their product is h bar over 2. That tells me that the Gaussian wave packet of the ground state of the harmonic oscillator is a minimum uncertainty wave packet. And if I look, so here's Misha's question. If I look at how big are the zero-point fluctuations of the charge in units of electrons, it's the ratio of the quantum impedance to the actual characteristic. So if this is of order the inverse by structure constant, then it's a few you're going to have a charge fluctuations on the capacitor are going to be a few electrons, or in the case of the superconductor, a few electrons. Now we'll be able to, when we introduce Joe's injections, we'll be able to make that impedance quite a bit higher. And or lower, depending on how you set up the circuit, and make this number bigger or smaller. But that's a sort of typical number for a quantum circuit. So then, of course, the Hamiltonian is h bar times the resonance frequency times a dagger a plus half. A dagger is the raising operator of the energy, and you should think of it as the operator that created the photon. So what does that mean that there's a photon in this electric circuit? Well, it's oscillating, and there's an electric field which happens to live over here, and there's a magnetic field which happens to live in a different place. But really, it's, you know, it's the moral equivalent of having quantized the standing wave modes in a cavity that you might be used to from regular cavity QE. And you can represent, if you were an electrical engineer and you'd like to think about circuits, you can represent all of these in terms of some complex set of LC oscillators, whether it's standing waves in the cavity or modes in an optical fiber or coplanar waveguides in a microwave circuit. So we've developed a kind of general procedure for quantizing such circuits, which we call black box quantization, barbecue sometimes. And the message of what I just told you is if I have a black box, I don't necessarily know what's inside, but I can attach electrical measuring apparatus and measure the impedance as a function of frequency. So the ratio if I have an infinite impedance current source oscillating and driving this at some frequency, and I measure the resulting voltage, the ratio of the two is given by the impedance. Someone's trying to sell me a vacation plan. I can either literally do that measurement, or I can use a finite element Maxwell equation solver like HFSS or COMSOL and compute what the characteristic impedance function is. And once I have that function, I can get the quantities that I need to do the quantum mechanics, namely the mode frequencies, are going to be the poles of this function, and the residues of those poles are going to be the characteristic impedances of the resonances. So let's do this, let's repeat the calculation we just did for a single LC oscillator. And we're electrical engineers, so we don't use time dependence e to the minus I omega t, we use e to the j omega t. Convert from quantum mechanics to electrical engineering, you just write J as minus I. Okay. Engineers use I for current. So the nice thing about the electrical engineering notation is there's never any minus signs. So the characteristic impedance of these two guys in parallel is J omega C plus 1 over J omega L. It's the inverse impedance is the sum of the two impedances. And I can write this function in this form. Okay, I lied, there's a minus sign. And you can see that there's a number with units of impedance, namely the characteristic impedance vertical over C that I introduced before. And then there's this dimensionless function of frequency, which has a pole at the resonance frequency. So this function, if I knew Z of omega, I could get ZR and I could get omega R. That's all I need to quantize the circuit. And the residue of this pole is just the, tells me what the characteristic impedance is. Okay. So if I just gave you a black box and you attached current source, tried different frequencies and found where it resonated. You measured the voltage near there and got the residue of the pole in the impedance. You could then quantize that circuit without knowing exactly what's inside. Okay. So knowing frequency and impedance, you can work out what L and C are separately. That's the other way to say it. And then you have the amplitude. Okay? Questions? All right. Well, in general, inside my black box, you know, I might have some setup like this where my terminals just connect to a little antenna, and there's a big empty box inside with all kinds of not lumped element, but distributed electromagnetic modes. Then, of course, there are going to be many, many modes inside there. Each one is going to have a pole, and the location of those poles will tell me the frequency of the modes, and the residue of those poles will tell me the characteristic impedances. And there's a theorem from 1927, I think, in the Bell Labs Technical Journal by this guy Foster that said you can represent any system as an equivalent circuit with a bunch of a series array of parallel resonators that may also be an inductor or a capacitor. And so the mode, if there's a photon in one of the modes, there's an oscillation going on in this guy, but not the other guys, or in that guy, but not this guy. And when one of these guys contributes a pole, at some frequency, the impedance of the other parts is possibly large, but it's analytic. And so when you take this limit of omega minus some pole frequency times this whole bunch of guys in series, you're going to get the residue of the pole for whichever guy is resonating at that frequency. Then I can write the flux variable here as a superposition of the flux variables, because they add in series for each of the separate oscillators. And I can compute this quantity knowing the frequency and the characteristic impedance of each resonance. Correct. So now I have, and this is the equivalent of having your cavity mode and many, you know, an infinite number of degrees of freedom, finding the normal and quantizing that you might be used to from the time conditions. Okay. If I don't start getting questions, I'm going to start asking questions. Be careful. All right, so now that's our cavity or our photons. Now we need an artificial atom to couple to. And there are many flavors of superconducting qubits. I'm going to talk to you about the simplest and one that actually works the best. And it's just a dipole antenna about a millimeter long. We're going to be working at transition frequencies of 5 gigahertz, which is sort of centimeter waves. So this is, the antenna is smaller. It's not a half-wave dipole antenna like on radio station. It's shorter than that, but it still couples to the electromagnetic flows. And the two halves of the antenna are going to be connected by the Joseph junctions. I'll explain that momentarily. But this is aluminum, it's superconducting. Cooper pairs are able to tunnel through this tunnel junction and slosh back and forth. So there are large fluctuations. It's an anharmonic oscillator, it turns out. But our analysis from before will be useful, as we'll see. So if the charge uncertainty is a few Cooper pairs, and they're moving a millimeter, you can imagine that's a gigantic dipole moment compared to the 1S2B transition of hydrogen. And we can get stupendously strong coupling to the electromagnetic field. So the Hamiltonian, these act like the plates of a capacitor. So the Hamiltonian is very similar to before. It's charge squared divided by the capacitance, C sigma, meaning the sum capacitance of, there's a tunnel junction, which is just an aluminum oxide insulator aluminum, so it has its own capacitance. That's the junction capacitance. And then there's geometric capacitance from these big pieces of aluminum in the antenna. And then instead of, this guy acts like a kind of nonlinear inductor. Instead of having an inductive energy that goes like flux squared, turns out it goes like cosine flux. And this quantity, the flux, divided, multiplied by 2 pi, divided by the superconducting flux quantum, that is just an angular variable phi, which is the superconducting condensate order parameter phase difference across the junctions. And you can see why that is, because the Josephson relation, which says that h bar times the time rate of change of the phase is the Cooper pair charge times the voltage. So this phase angle and the flux are linearly related. Okay. The reason that this is cosine is because it's related to the fact that charge can only discretely tunnel. You can't tunnel a tenth of a Cooper pair. It has to be an integer number of Cooper pairs. And the periodicity of this under phase goes to phase plus 2 pi is deeply connected to the discreteness of the charge. But it turns out in the limit that this so-called Josephson coupling energy, which is a measure of how readily the Cooper pairs can tunnel, as long as that's much bigger than the charging energy, then the zero-point fluctuations of this phase angle are small, and you can expand the cosine. So I'm sweeping some interesting details under the rug, but typically this ratio is at least 100, and those details don't matter much. So think of this as, you can think of this as a quantum rotor, where this is the angular momentum squared, and this is the gravitational potential pulling the rotor down here. And when EJ is strong, that's strong gravity, and the rotor is trying to stay down here. And the ground state wave function is localized near zero angle. And because it's a cosine potential and not a parabola, not phi squared, it's going to be an anharmonic oscillator. It'll turn out to be weakly anharmonic, anharmonic enough that we can use it as an artificial map at two levels. Okay, so without going into details, I'm just saying that it's legitimate to expand the cosine of the power series in many circumstances. And in many circumstances, it works very well. So let's start with H naught is the charging energy plus the quadratic part of the Josephson call the Josephson inductance energy, because it looks just like phi squared over 2 times some inductance, which is called the Josephson inductance. So that's what this one is. And then this guy, so we're neglecting the 4-wave mixing, the 3, 4, 5, 6-wave mixing that's up here for now. And we have a harmonic oscillator. It's called the Josephson plasma oscillation. So the charges are sloshing back and forth in conjunction between the two halves of the antenna and making a harmonic oscillator. The characteristic energy of that oscillator is, I'm missing an H bar here, sorry, it's the geometric mean of the two energies of the Josephson. Charging, a funny factor of 8 that comes from the fact that we define our charging energy as the energy to put one electron, not one Cooper pair, across the capacitor. Some sort of historical reason, because people started out with, not in the non-superconducting case, with single electron transistors. So the characteristic frequencies will be 5 to 10 gigahertz. And now I'm going to write my perturbation. V is going to be this part minus the quadratic part, so all the higher order parts. And I'm going to have 4-wave mixing, 6-wave mixing, 8-wave mixing. And when we do numerical calculations, we sometimes include these things, but for many purposes, in a certain limit, the 4-wave mixing is all we need. So I'm going to think of my Josephson junction circuit as a linear inductor, that's this part, and a linear capacitor, that's the Josephson junction capacitance, and any stray geometric capacitance from the antenna. That's my LC oscillator. And then then I'm going to draw this funny symbol for the nonlinear part of the circuit, the nonlinear inductance. when I write, so I'm going to use the basis of eigenstate for the harmonic oscillator to express the four-way mixing. And I'm going to make some rotating wave approximations, and I'm going to get this result. That there's a small shift in the quadratic part of the Hamiltonian when I normal order, when I write phi as a plus a dagger, raise it to the fourth power, and normal order it, there's a quadratic part and there's a chordic part. And the size of the anharmonicity is the charging. So I end up with my Hamiltonian is a weakly anharmonic oscillator. I'm going to use alpha to represent the anharmonicity, not the fine structure kind of, but I'm reusing the symbol alpha. The frequency of the oscillator is slightly shifted downward from what the Josen plasma frequency was by that normal ordering effect. This is just quantum electrodynamic renormalization of the mass charge of the electron coming into play here. And it turns out that a lot of these renormalization effects are much easier to handle here, especially in the infinities, because the atom is so close to a harmonic oscillator that you can take a lot of these things into effect and make them come down exactly. But there'll be lamp shifts and all those things that you're used to from the time. Okay, then there'll be anharmonicity, which is the charging energy divided by h bar, and it'll be typically on the scale of 200 megahertz out of 5 megahertz. So it's a weakly anharmonic oscillator. The transition from level 0 to 1 will be this, and from 1 to 2 will be this minus 200 megahertz. Okay? So if I apply a microwave field and try stations of the atom through the antenna, as long as the Rabi driving rate, capital omega, is a lot smaller than the anharmonicity, I'm not going to excite up the ladder. And so I can approximate the atom as a two-level. And so in some sense, it's a weakly anharmonic oscillator. But in another sense, it's a strong enough anharmonicity that I can treat it as a two-level atom. And so for weak enough drive. That makes sense? So I need anharmonicity to make an artificial atom, because I can't Rabi flop something if it has exactly equal level spacing. That's why we have a Josen. Okay. So now I want to couple my artificial atom to the modes, electromagnetic modes of a box. Okay, so I'm going to have my artificial atom, whose circuit equivalent is the Josen inductance, the Josen capacitance, the antenna, which has capacitance. Before I just called it a capacitor, but now I'm calling it an antenna coupled to the modes of this box. And then I have my term in the Hamiltonian represented by this funny symbol, which is the non-harmonic part. And in order to write V of phi in terms of photon operators, I need to know the characteristic impedance of this black box at these terminals. So that's why we went through the whole black box quantization scheme. If I can write phi as a sum over the normal mode, inputs inside this box calculated without this guy present, then I have a very good basis in which to write down the four-way mixing. So I do my black box quantization, I calculate all these quantities, and then I plug this in. So equivalently, I'm diagonalizing the quadratic part of the Hamiltonian. Now, the atom, the antenna, the box, all of that, getting a good basis and then expressing V in that basis. And then because of normal ordering, there'll be some quadratic parts. I'm using capital A's now to be creation operators for the normal modes. And then there'll be some four-wave mixing parts, which in a rotating wave approximation will be what we call cross-curve effects, that the energy to add the quanta to this mode depends on how many quanta there are in that mode. Okay? And then when J is equal to K, it's a self-curve effect inherited by all the modes from the self-curve non-linearity of the artificial atom. So the atom hybridizes with all the harmonic modes of the box, and they develop cross-curve interactions and self-curve interactions. So you find all these modes, and the one that is most anharmonic, the one with the largest self-curve, I will call the atom-like mode, even though it's dose production is now hybridized with the photons in the cavity, so to speak. I'm going to call that a qubit-like mode. Let's call that, let's say, J0. So chi 0, 0, the self-curve is big. And then the cross-curve between the atom-like mode and the cavity photon-like mode, 0, chi 0, k, is the next biggest. Then the self-interactions of the photon-like modes, because they're mostly out here in the cavity and not so much on the atom, they inherit the least non-linearity. Does that make sense? So now, if I have my artificial atom as this anharmonic oscillator, and if it's true that I'm only weakly Robbie-flopping it, so I can focus only on the bottom two bubbles. So I'm going to assume that the number of quanta in the most anharmonic mode is going to be either 0 or 1. Then I can map that onto the two states of an artificial spin. And recover a cross-curve interaction, which looks like what you get out of the ordinary James-Cummings model when you have the atom detuned from the cavity and you can make the dispersive interaction with isolation. Namely, the mode frequency in the cavity frequency depends on whether the qubit is in the ground state or the excited. And I can then use that to read out the qubit. Are you okay with that? So I didn't go through, taking the quadratic part of the Hamiltonian, I could have said, there's a mode here with some dipole moment that has a James-Cummings G that couples to the photons of the cavity and then diagonalize that. But I kind of skipped over all of that and arrived at what result you would get of doing James-Cummings and then making the dispersive transformation. So here's a picture of the artificial atom. Here's the cavity, or one half of the cavity is two pieces of 6066 aircraft aluminum, which contains magnesium, which is why airplanes burn so well when they crash. And it also contains impurities and iron and all kinds of junk, but it still superconducts pretty well. It's easy to machine. And there's a piece of sapphire in the middle, and you glue the two halves of the cavity together. here's a blown up picture of the transmon qubit evaporated on the surface of the sapphire, which is a very good low loss detector. Here's your millimeter antenna, and there's the Joseph junction. So again, in the James Cummings language, where you have a dipole moment from the charge fluctuations coupling to the electric field of a cavity where G is this sort of 100 megahertz, the transition dipole moment is a few Cooper pairs, 1 to 5, moving a millimeter. So it's a big dipole moment, and you can get very strong coupling to the electromagnetic field. So if you're in the excited stage, you can fall down and emit a photon or absorb a photon and jump up. And that's the source of the strong coupling. So through various, this qubit design is the simplest, but it's the result of many years of design changes and different schemes for doing qubits. And the coherence times have risen roughly 6 orders of magnitude in the last few years. So that's good, just engineering, simplifying the processes and the design enablement, and thinking of designs that are insensitive to some of the random noise sources that occur in these guys are ugly solid state systems. Can't get rid of that, so we just try to make it insensitive. So now we've quantized the artificial atom, we've quantized the artificial atom coupled to modes of the cavity. Now let's talk about dispersive coupling and readout. And basically, this cross curve between the atom and the cavity modes. When you write the atom as a two-level system, it tells you that the frequency of the cavity now depends on the state of the qubit. So if you have some weak dispersive coupling, maybe the cavity moves 1 or 2 lengths, and depending on the state of the qubit. And then you can, you can send in microwaves through a circulator, bounce them off the resonator, and then using a quantum limited parametric amplifier, which is made possible by the 6 orders of magnitude progress in qubit lifetimes and some clever engineering that's been done in the last decade, you can amplify this tiny signal, which is contains fractions of a photon. This is an amplifier which, if you sent a 1 watt cell phone signal from the moon, would overload. And because the atom has a different frequency from the cavity, and you're sending in, say, a frequency here near the cavity frequency, the atom can't actually absorb the photons, but it can affect the frequency. It can virtually absorb and re-emit. So it comes out at the same frequency, but maybe with a different phase. And you can detect that phase through the resonance frequency shift of the cavity. You can do a homodyne measurement and detect the state of the atom. So the incoming state is, let's say, the atom is in a superposition of up and down, and the microwaves are in a coherent state, alpha, some amplitude and phase. And what comes out is now entangled. The photons have phase e to the I theta times alpha if the qubit's up, and e to the minus I theta alpha if the qubit's down, where theta is this phase shift. So this is a real quantum measurement done the real way. Namely, you take your little quantum system, you entangle it with the state of a meter, then you read the meter. The meter in this case is the pile of photons that are in the microwave pulse, and then you read that with the amplifier. So here are raw data for measuring that Hoberdine signal and seeing it jump every once in a while as the artificial atom jumps back and forth, so you can see quantum jumps when it's being weakly rockified. And readout fidelity is about 99.5% at 300 minutes. Just gets it to be shorter. Okay, the clock may go a little bit longer. So I just described a kind of weak dispersive limit where the atom changes state and pulls the cavity maybe a one line width. But we can be in the strong dispersive limit where the detuning of the cavity and the qubit is very large, but the cavity-qubit coupling is very strong. And you can get into a regime. So here's a line which is sort of resonant, where the strength of the coupling is about the same size or larger than the detuning. That's a resonant case. When the detuning is very large, that's the dispersive case. But the coupling can be so large that even the second order effects of the coupling, namely the dispersive shift chi, which is basically this thing, can be much larger than the alignment. And when this was first published, we were here. Now we're out here somewhere. So here's the case where this chi tells you that the cavity frequency shifts many line widths. The cavity has a line width kappa. And depending on the state of the qubit, the cavity can move 2,000 line widths. So that's the second order effects, the virtual dispersive coupling effects of the cavity and the qubit being extremely strong, not just the first order. So when you're in that limit, then of course it's even one single photon, accidentally thermal photon, bouncing off the cavity, we'll figure out whether the cavity had this resonance frequency or that one, and you've collapsed the state of the system. You make a very strong measurement using one photon. So you want to try to avoid that. There's another way of looking at this same term, which is that it's not the coefficient of A dagger A, namely the cavity frequency that depends on sigma z. Rather, the coefficient of sigma z depends on how many photons are in the cavity. That is, there's a quantized, just rearrange the parentheses here and say, oh look, the qubit transition frequency is now shifted by 2 chi each time I add a photon to the cavity. And if I put a coherent state in the cavity, which has 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 photons, you're uncertain which number it is, but it's a distribution of them, you can apply a tone to the qubit, try to excite it, then measure whether it got excited. So that's quantum jump spectroscopy. You can measure the spectrum of the qubit and see all these different transition frequencies shifted by the quantized light shift, and discovered that microwaves, despite their name, are actually particles. And I told you this was 2,000 line widths here, but these lines are actually power brought by a factor of 100 to do the experiment in a hurry, so you don't see that full resolution. The lines are extremely sharp compared to this thing. Did some, what I think is kind of a novel paper on using this possibility to make a microwave photon counter that will speed up the search for axion dark matter particles, which are able to turn into microwave photons, speed up such searches by orders of magnitude. Okay, so the final thing is photon number parity measurement. And running out of time, so maybe I'll start with that next time. But it turns out that with this strong coupling, where the atom cavity dispersive coupling is thousands of line widths, it's possible to measure the photon number parity without measuring the photon number. And that's going to turn out to be an extremely powerful tool for making interesting photon states, including cat states, and for making syndrome measurements in quantum error correction codes